So the main reason I'm here is to introduce the scientific speaker for the afternoon. So you already had a great presentation from Dr. Corelli this morning. This afternoon, we're joined by Dr. Patrick Uwiman, another renowned scientist, very highly regarded internationally. It's a great honor to have him involved in the conference and to agree to speak here. I'll give you a brief background to him. Again, you could spend a half an hour introducing people like this. It's so impressive what they've done. But he's an academic ophthalmologist by training. He's based at Newcastle University in the UK, a specialist research interest in mitochondrial eye disorders. That sounds like a pretty good fit for the session. His aim is to understand why the eye is selectively vulnerable in mitochondrial disease and how we can best manage patients with these problems. A major objective of his work is how knowledge gained in the lab can be translated into more effective treatment strategies for this group of patients. Dr. Uwiman is a member of the Mitochondrial Research Group at Newcastle, so one of the largest, most active groups in the world in mitochondrial research. That's part of the Wellcome Trust Center for Mitochondrial Research. He's been involved with research in this area since as an undergraduate. Dr. Uwiman worked as a research assistant with Drs. Chinnery and Doug Turnbull, so two more luminaries in mitochondrial research back in 2000, 2001. And at that time, the project was trying to clarify the molecular genetics of LHON. So, this is a scientist that has really dedicated his professional career to understanding LHON. So, without further ado, I'll turn it over to Dr. Uwiman. And you get a twofer. He's going to do two talks. The first is extraocular clinical features in LHON. And the second will be treatment strategies for LHON, hopes and challenges. Felt like those were two topics that really could be separated. So, Dr.
Right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks very much for the introduction, Phil. And it's a great privilege for me to be here today to take part in this long patient day. And really, Lisa has done an amazing job in the background putting the program together and working tirelessly on top of everything that she has to do from her day-to-day activities. And I think we all feel in the audience here that we've reached a critical phase in terms of research in this mitochondrial disorder, where now we are really reaching a stage where new treatment strategies are coming around the corner that we hope will make a big difference to patients and their families. We're going to hear more about treatment in the second half of my talk, and what I want to do is to focus on what Lisa just mentioned in her first presentation about this condition where patients, in addition to having visual loss from Leber's optic neuropathy, can also develop some extraocular features. And in terms of financial disclosures, I don't have any personal financial relationships or conflicts of interest. I've attended a couple of clinical advisory board meetings, but again, I don't own any stocks and shares. Mitochondria are fascinating in organelles because they are these little tiny batteries present in every cell in the human body. And the reason why we need mitochondria is very simple. It's there to produce energy because we need energy for everything that we do on a day-to-day basis, and your cells need energy to function properly. And in terms of human disease, starting in 1988 with the identification of the first Leber's mutation by Dr. Doug Wallace, we now know that there's a whole range of these pathogenic mutations, these spelling mistakes within the mitochondrial genome which can cause human disease. And there are more than 200 of these pathogenic point mutations that have been reported. And at the same time, you can also have a situation where parts of the mitochondrial genome is deleted. And these mitochondrial DNA deletions are also an important cause of human disease. And the reason why I'm mentioning this is because it is really something which is becoming increasingly relevant in terms of mitochondrial medicine. You know, when things first started, people used to think that mitochondrial disorders were very rare. But actually, we now know that it affects at least 1 in 5,000 people in the general population. And I'm sure that as people have better access to genetic testing and more genes are identified, this figure will simply go up. And what sometimes makes the diagnosis quite difficult is patients can develop a whole range of clinical features. And both within and between families, there can be a wide range of presentation with the same mitochondrial mutation. And the reason why I got involved with mitochondrial disorders, well, nearly 14 years ago now, is because I got interested in the ocular side of things, because we now know that more than half of these patients will develop significant eye problems. And as Valerio mentioned this morning, optic nerve involvement is a classical manifestation of mitochondrial disease, and the paradigm is this condition labors optic neuropathy that I'm going to talk about now. So LON is a primary mitochondrial genetic disorder, as all of you in the audience will know. And if we look at the actual mutations involved, three-point mutations within the mitochondrial genome account for the vast majority of cases. And these mutations are located by their position. So you have 3460, 11778, and 14484, with the 11778 mutation being the most common mutation worldwide. Except if you're in French Canada, where 14484 is much more common because of a founding event. And retinal ganglion cells are these specialized cells at the back of your eye. And the reason why we have these retinal ganglion cells is because they convert visual information into electrical signals. And then these electrical signals are sent to the brain to be processed, and that's how you see. And the axons of these 1.2 million retinal ganglion cells converge into a bundle to form the optic nerve, which is a cable connecting the eye to the vision centers in the brain. And this is a big mystery in this condition, because in a vast majority of patients, these retinal ganglion cells are the only cells which are affected, causing visual loss. There are a lot of theories, and there's more data now about why retinal ganglion cells should be preferentially affected, which I'm not going to cover. But this is a major area of research, because if we can understand this preferential vulnerability better, then we can come up with better treatment. And in terms of how patients with Leber's optic neuropathy present, it is one of the most dramatic presentations in neuro-ophthalmology, where patients will present with painless central visual loss, normally in one eye. But sometimes in 25% of cases, both eyes are affected at the same time. And there is severe reduction in vision, down to 660. That's just the UK notation. 660 is the top letter on the standard vision chart. So we're talking about very significant severe loss of vision here. And if only one eye is affected initially, the second eye usually becomes affected 3 to 6 months later, but definitely within a year of the first eye being affected. So this is really the classical presentation of this condition. Bilateral loss of vision, normally in young adult males. But what I want to focus on for the remainder of this presentation are patients that have LON plus syndromes. It is a bit of a vague term. It encompasses quite a lot of different conditions, but I think it's quite a good term to use here where we want to put the focus more on the extraocular features. So what most people in the audience want to know is whether or not the disease is only limited to the optic nerve, when a patient has a classical mitochondrial DNA mutation that causes LON. And in the majority of patients, the answer is yes, it's only the optic nerve which is affected. And except for visual loss, most of these patients lead normal, fit, healthy lifestyle with no impact on their life expectancy. So this is classical LON. There's a bit of feedback here. Patients normally have one of these three classical mutations, 3460, 11778, and 14484. It normally affects young adult males, and there is a bilateral loss of vision. But as I've mentioned already, you have a huge number of these mutations, these spelling mistakes within the mitochondrial genome. And if you open any textbook or any paper or any website, you will see that there's a whole range of these mitochondrial syndromes that can be associated with these mutations. I'm not going to mention all of them, but some of them are still known by their classical names, for example, NARP, MELAS, MERF, Lee syndrome. And it really tells you that very often as doctors we struggle with coming up with a diagnosis, so we just use a term, but now we know that the same term like MELAS can be caused by different mutations. And as part of these various mitochondrial syndromes, of course, the optic nerve can be affected. But normally, it is part of a cluster of other neurological features, which very often are much more significant compared to the optic nerve being involved. So this is really where things can overlap. You have an overlap between classical LON and then these mitochondrial syndromes. And I'm going to mention some of these overlap syndromes to you. So this is nothing new. Even before the gene was identified, people knew that some patients with classical labors also develop other extraocular features. But the difficulty has always been that LON is a rare disorder. And on top of that, some people develop extraocular features, so it's an even rarer group. So how do we know whether this is actually related to the LON mutation or whether this is just a coincidence? And this is a very difficult area. So I'm just going to mention some of the extraocular features where there's probably a bit more evidence to suggest that there is a causal link between the mutation, visual loss, and the extraocular features. I'm going to talk about brain problems that might be linked with labors. Some patients also can develop muscle weakness, peripheral nerve problems, hearing loss, and I'm going to mention cardiac problems because it's something which is relevant in terms of something that could be potentially life-threatening. So let's start with cardiac problems first. So this paper was published back in 1994 by Professor Eva Nikoskilainen, where she did a study of 24 families with LON. And what she did was basically look at ECG recordings, to look at heart tracing from these patients, to determine whether or not there was any abnormal heart rhythm. And what she found was that 5 out of 51 patients, about 10% of them, had ECG features of the Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. So Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome is just a cardiac problem where patients can develop palpitations. And in her study, 2 of these patients had ventricular tachycardia, which is a cause of sudden cardiac death. So it's an abnormal heart rhythm that needs to be treated because it is definitely life-threatening. But because this is an important question to clarify, other research groups have looked into this question of whether patients with LON have an increased risk of cardiac arrhythmias. And this is one study that was carried out in Australia by Dr. David Mackey. And in this study, he did not find any increased frequency of cardiac arrhythmias comparing affected carriers and affected carriers compared with controls. And certainly also, I'm going to mention the Rhodes trial that looked at treatment of vidabinone in patients with labors. But in this study, as part of a trial, you have to be very rigorous. So all these patients had a baseline examination where they also had ECGs. And none of these patients had any significant ECG abnormalities like the Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. So overall, the message seems to be that patients with LON do not have an increased risk of serious cardiac arrhythmias or sudden cardiac death. And it could be that a study from Finland is geographically related, that these patients might have some other predisposing factor to develop cardiac arrhythmias. It is certainly sensible to carry out a baseline ECG if there are cardiac symptoms like palpitation. And in any case, most patients will have an ECG at some point by their family doctor or by their internal family physician. But I personally don't think there is any increased evidence of cardiac problems in patients with LON. So moving on to brain problems. If you look at LON in PubMed or Google, there's a whole list of case reports or anecdotal stories of patients with LON developing other disorders affecting the central nervous system. And again, the main thing that we need to do is to look at the evidence and decide whether or not there is a true causal relationship or whether it could just be coincidence. Whether it's a coincidence or not, it still has to be detected, it still has to be treated. But as scientists, we always want to establish whether there's a clear link between the mutation and between these extraocular features. And I'm going to mention 3 extraocular features where there is more evidence to suggest a causal relationship. I'm going to talk about dystonia, myoclonus, and also importantly, multiple sclerosis. So dystonia is the first thing I'm going to mention. It is a movement disorder, which is caused by faulty brain signals. And what happens in dystonia, patients develop uncontrollable and sometimes rather painful muscle spasms. And because of these muscle spasms, parts of the body can get pulled into abnormal postures and abnormal positions. And I've just mentioned these two papers here. I don't have a laser pointer, so you can. I'm just going to point towards them. There are other case reports in the... Thanks very much, Lisa. There are other case reports in the literature, but this is a case report from Nijmegen in the Netherlands and a series here from the Newcastle Mitochondrial Group where I'm based. And overall, if you look at all the data, you can make a case that there is a possible association between dystonia and Leber's optic neuropathy. So the other extraocular feature I'm going to mention is myoclonus, which again is a movement disorder caused by abnormal brain signals. And in myoclonus, you get these involuntary electric shock jerking of a muscle or group of muscle. And although it's not exactly the same, that's what we sometimes get when we're just about to fall asleep, where you get this sudden jerking of your body. And these papers have come from Valerio Carelli's group from Bologna. And again, if you put all the information together, you can make a case that there is a link between myoclonus and the LON mutations in some families. It's still rare, but the link can be made a bit more strongly. So I'm going to talk now about the link with multiple sclerosis. And Valerio mentioned that already in his talk, but neurons are really beautiful things because here you have a neuron with a cell body, and with the axon here, which is basically a cable that's going to connect to another neuron. And the cable here is connected, is protected by this myelin sheath to help the electrical signal go down the cable much faster. And what happens in multiple sclerosis, it's a complex disease, but you get loss of this myelin coating. And this is the pathological hallmark of multiple sclerosis. So patients with multiple sclerosis can develop a wide range of neurological features, but visual problems are very important because more than 40% of these patients will develop visual problems at some point because of inflammation of the optic nerve, which is known as optic neuritis. And when you do an MRI scan, you can see evidence of inflammation of the optic nerve, like in this patient here, where the right optic nerve has this abnormal bright signal, which indicates that there is inflammation there. So I'm just going to mention optic neuritis because very often patients with LON initially get diagnosed as having optic neuritis before the penny drops that actually no, it's not optic neuritis, but it is a mitochondrial optic nerve problem. So in optic neuritis, there is acute reduction in vision in one eye over a few days. The majority of patients will report pain around the eye, and very often the pain is worse when you move the eyes around. And the thing about optic neuritis is that there's very rapid visual recovery without treatment. So this is a very important paper that came out in Brain in 1992. I've provided you with a reference here, with Anita Harding being the first author. She was a very prominent neurologist based at Queen Square in London. And the last author is Alastair Comston, who is a world expert in multiple sclerosis. And this really fascinating paper, they describe 8 female LON carriers with the 11778 mutation. And in addition to visual loss, these female carriers also developed a neurological syndrome that was indistinguishable from typical multiple sclerosis. And that's why some people refer to this LON-MS overlap syndrome as Harding's disease. So I'm just going to illustrate that with an example of a patient that I saw recently in my clinic with my neurology colleague, Patrick Chinry. She's a 37-year-old woman with multiple episodes of sequential visual loss in both eyes. She had her first episode of optic neuritis, what was thought to be optic neuritis, back when she was 17 years old. And every time that she had an episode, she recovered vision, but never fully. So she lost a bit of vision every time she had an episode. So this is just her vision when she was last in clinic at the end of last year. And 660 is the top Latin division chart. 656 is one line below. So over the years, she's developed significant loss of vision, and both optic discs were pale. And if you look at OCT here, which is just a way of measuring the thickness of the nerve fibrillaria, you can see that there's been significant loss of these retinal ganglion cells over time. But then what became quite interesting is, as she was investigated, this is her MRI scan, and she had these classical periventricular white matter changes that you see in multiple sclerosis. She had this spinal tap, and there were unmatched oligoclonal bands in the cerebrospinal fluid. And what this means is these bands give you a clear indication that there was an immune process, that her body was mounting an immunological reaction that was causing loss of myelin around the nerve cells in the brain. So that's why a lot of patients we suspected multiple sclerosis will be having a spinal tap as part of the investigation. And to cut a long story short, she met the diagnostic criteria for relapsing remitting MS as she was being followed. But then her brother also developed visual loss later on. But that was a classical lung presentation with bilateral loss of vision happening within 2 months of each other. And he was found to have the 11, 7, and 8 mitochondrial DNA mutation. And the brother, unlike the sister, only had visual problems. He did not have any lung features, and he did not have any abnormal MRI changes. So all of this kind of led us very recently to have a look at this overlap syndrome of Lund MS. And the work was done by Jerry Pfeffer, who was a research fellow that came from Canada to spend 3 years to do his research with the Newcastle Mitochondrial Group. And the two main questions was whether there was any difference between classical Lund and Lund MS, and secondly, whether Lund carriers had an increased risk of multiple sclerosis. So as part of this study, we were able to review 56 patients who had Lund MS. And the first one I want to make is that this overlap syndrome is associated with all three primary Lund mutations. Most of them had the 11, 7, 7, 8 mutation, 80%, but there were carriers with 3460 and the 14484 mutation, because originally Anita Harding described the link with 11778, but now we know that all three of them can be associated with Lund MS. So I just want to show you this table just to make a comparison between these three diseases: classical Lund, optic neuritis, and Lund MS. The first part I want to discuss is the sex ratio between male and female. So as we know already, Leber's optic neuropathy is a disease of young adult males. And the figure can vary, but males have 4 times the risk of losing vision compared to female carriers. When we look at optic neuritis, it's the reverse. It's a disease with female bias, where you have 3 times more affected female than male patients. And for Lund MS, there is a female bias, with twice as many affected women as men. In terms of age of onset, there's nothing much to say here, because it's a disease that tends to affect young people in their third and fourth decades of life. Ocular pain is interesting because it's very unusual for patients with classical Lund to report pain, whereas in patients with optic neuritis linked with demyelination and multiple sclerosis, the majority of patients will report ocular pain, more than 90%. And in Lund MS, it's about 50%. So not as much as in classical demyelinative optic neuritis, but certainly very different from classical Lund. And in terms of visual recovery, unfortunately, visual recovery in classical Lund is very limited. It's very good in optic neuritis, and it's only partial in Lund MS, like the case I presented, this lady who every time she had an episode, she lost a bit of vision, so over a period of 20 years, she ended up with significant loss of vision. So Lund MS appears to be distinct from both classical Lund and classical multiple sclerosis. And I think that's one of the things that most people in the audience will want to know. And certainly looking at the data, there was no convincing evidence to suggest that a Lund carrier has an increased risk of developing multiple sclerosis. So the obvious thing is whether Non-MS therefore represents an interaction between two distinct disorders, because this is very important in terms of understanding the mechanisms leading to retinal ganglion cell loss. And there is increasing evidence that mitochondrial dysfunction is very important in terms of leading to axonal loss in multiple sclerosis. And these are just two papers published by members of the Newcastle Mitochondrial Group, where they've looked at this link between mitochondrial dysfunction and loss of neurons in multiple sclerosis. And as we know, right, okay, the reason why we have these mitochondria in our cells is to produce energy. You have all these complexes here on the inner membrane of the mitochondria, complex 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And these are embedded within the inner membrane. And all three primary loan mutations affect complex 1, right? So basically, if complex 1 is no longer working properly, the whole chain becomes disrupted, and you get a reduction in the amount of energy which is being produced. And because you have a lot of these electrons floating around here, you have also increased levels of these reactive oxygen species, which are pretty nasty stuff for the cell because they increase the risk of your cell dying prematurely. So really, the interesting story here is that these pathogenic LON mutations could therefore be potentiating axonal loss and leading to increased neurological disability. But this is really among individuals who already have a pre-existing predisposition to developing multiple sclerosis. And I think the last thing I want to mention here, and this is very new and this is very exciting in terms of mitochondrial research, there is increasing evidence that the release of mitochondrial DNA from damaged neurons can also trigger inflammation and precipitate cell death. So if you have a cell which is in trouble and the cell explodes because it's dying, you release all these mitochondrial DNA, which then trigger inflammation. So you have a scenario where optic nerve damage in lung could therefore contribute to an immune process, which then leads on to an immunological cascade that eventually affects the brain, and then you get these abnormal white matter changes in the brain. So this is still an evolving story, but my personal feeling is that it's telling us a lot of fundamental facts, not just about labels of the neuropathy, but also about demyelination and multiple sclerosis. So just to summarize the main points, because I know I've covered quite a few things here, the majority of patients with LON will only develop bilateral visual loss. And I think this is an important point to make. Extraocular features have been associated with all three primary LON mutations, and there's a whole list that I could put here. But the one thing that we need to keep in mind is that it is quite difficult to establish a causal link between these extraocular features and LON MS. And what I've done is basically focus on those where there's much more evidence on in the published literature. And whether or not it's linked to the LON mutation, as doctors, we need to be aware of it, because if your patient has any of these extraocular features, you should make sure that it gets treated and managed properly to reduce the risk of secondary complication. Thank you very much. So I think we'll be taking questions next with a Q&A session. I'm going to move on now to my second presentation. So two for the price of one, Lisa. Right. So this is the area where there's been a lot of exciting developments for the past few years. And I'm going to talk about treatment strategies for Leber's optic neuropathy and the progress that has been made. But certainly there's a lot of challenges left ahead of us, and we need to, think hard about how we can pull forces together to make further advances in this field of research. So again, this is my financial disclosure. I don't have any personal financial relationship or conflicts of interest. And one of the things about Leber's optic neuropathy, and that's actually one of the work that I did as an undergraduate with Professor Turnbull and Professor Chinnery when I was just starting in this area of research, we look at the epidemiology of Leber's optic neuropathy in the north of England. So for those of you who don't really know where Newcastle is, Newcastle is here in the northeast, very close to Scotland. So if Scotland becomes independent in September, I will be a border town, right? But I don't think there will be any skirmishes. So the bottom line here is that LON is the most common mitochondrial genetic disorder in the population. And the minimum prevalence in the UK is 1 in 31,000. So it is rare, but not that rare. The terrible thing about this disorder is the visual prognosis is pretty dismal, because significant visual recovery is rare, and even if it does occur, it tends to be partial. And as a lot of people in the audience will know, the best visual prognosis is with a 14484 mutation. And in terms of the impact of this disease on patients that are unfortunate to be affected, it affects predominantly young adult men who are otherwise fit and well in themselves. And you can imagine how this will have a significant impact on someone's quality of life. And we've heard this amazing story this morning of patients who've gone through this whole process and have, you know, done their best to cope with their visual handicap. So what about treatment? What can we clinicians offer our patients that have been affected with this condition? Well, the first point to make is that treatment options still remain limited for Leber's optic neuropathy. And because treatment options are limited, we need to actually focus on supportive measures. So genetic counseling is very important, because people need to be aware about whether or not they have a risk of transmitting the mutation to the next generation. Patients need to be provided with access to low visual aids. And also they need to be supported in terms of occupational rehabilitation, because as we've heard this morning, a lot of patients, after a period of difficulty coping with the loss of vision, will then move on and get on with their lives and carry on working and be active members of society. And things are much easier because of social media and the work that Lisa and other people in the UK where I come from are doing, setting up these patient networks, allowing people to share their experiences, which makes it much easier to cope when you're faced with this really kind of depressing situation of losing your vision very quickly, when before then you were otherwise fit and well. So the support network is very important, and what I want to do now is focus more on the research side of things. What can we do to try and preserve these retinal ganglion cells, to try and preserve vision? The dream, of course, is to prevent visual loss to take place in the first place, but we're not there yet, so I think we're talking more in terms of preservation of vision. So I'm going to talk about the use of mitochondrial antioxidants. Valeria has mentioned this already in terms of activation of mitochondrial biogenesis in an affected carriers. I think it's also important to cover unproven therapies that people and their families can come across on Google and various other websites, because there's a lot of myths out there that needs to be debunked. I'm also going to talk about gene therapy, which is a very exciting new development in terms of treatment for this disorder. And finally, because I'm based in Newcastle, I will also mention strategies in terms of preventing the germline transmission of mitochondrial DNA mutation, and that includes the Leber's mutations. So let's now move on to part one, relating to mitochondrial antioxidants. I think the first thing to do is, as scientists, we want to look at the evidence with a clear head and check whether or not there is good evidence to use a treatment or not. And this is a systematic review of treatment for mitochondrial disease carried out by the who's who of mitochondrial medicine in the world. And the figures are very sobering, because out of 1,039 publications on treatment for mitochondrial diseases, only 35 of these studies had recruited more than 5 patients. So a lot of these studies were clearly anecdotal and clearly underpowered. So all of these things have been used. Coenzyme Q10, various supplements that you can buy from your health store online, like carnitine, creatinine, L-arginine, various combinations of vitamins, right? And really, they are safe. There's no doubt they are safe when used in moderation. But there is no convincing evidence that they are efficacious in mitochondrial diseases, and this includes LON. So I'm going to talk about idebenone from Santhera Pharmaceuticals, and everyone in the audience here will have heard about the work that has been done on using idebenone for treating patients with Leber's optic neuropathy. But what I want to do is provide you with a summary of the results of these various studies. So again, this is really just to emphasize the fact that all three primary LON mutations affect complex 1 subunits. And because of this, you get a reduction in energy production and increased levels of reactive oxygen species. And idebenone is a synthetic ubiquinone analog. It's like a second generation of coenzyme Q10. And what it does in a nutshell, it increases the amount of energy being produced, and it also reduces the level of these toxic reactive oxygen species. So it has a dual beneficial effect. And there's been anecdotal case reports and also a large case series from Japan suggesting that it could help patients with Leber's optic neuropathy. And with the support of Santhera, we were able to put together the logistics for a randomized controlled trial to look at the efficacy and safety of idebenone in patients with Leber's optic neuropathy. And this was a collaborative effort between three centers, Newcastle in England, Munich in Germany, and Montreal in Canada. And in terms of the inclusion criteria, patients had to be between the age of 14 and 64. They had to have a confirmed lung mutation, 3460117784. And the onset of visual loss was within the last 5 years. Ideally, you would want patients with acute loss of vision, but we had to be pragmatic in terms of recruitment, so we extended to up to 5 years and then did subgroup analysis afterwards. And 85 lung patients were successfully randomized. So what did we do in terms of treatment? The patients were randomized, blind, so neither the patient nor the doctor knew which treatment was being given, in a 2-to-1 randomization ratio. So 55 patients in the idebenone group and 30 in the placebo group. And the dose of idebenone that was used was 900 milligrams per day, so 300 milligrams three times daily. So patients were seen at various time points, and week 24 was the study endpoint. That's when you look at the data and you did the statistical analysis. So I'm going to show this figure here because it's relevant in terms of how the data was analyzed. So most patients with LON, after the acute phase, will have roughly the same level of vision in both eyes. So if one eye is counting fingers, the other eye will tend to be the same, i.e. counting fingers. So in the majority of these patients, concordant mean that there was very little difference between the two eyes. But there were 30 patients here that had discordant visual acuity, meaning that, let me just go forward. And in this group here, there was a difference of more than 0.2 logMAR. So 0.2 logMAR are two lines on the vision chart, so quite a big difference. So our hypothesis was that these patients were at highest risk of disease progression. Essentially, the second eye still had reasonably better vision, and therefore you'd expect that there was a better chance of you rescuing the vision in that second eye. So the important thing was the safety data, because we don't want to use any treatment which is unsafe for our patients. So idebenone was very well tolerated at the dose of 900 milligrams per day. There were no adverse drug-related reactions, which is very reassuring. And we know from other work that has been done, because idebenone has been used in other randomized controlled trials for Friedreich's ataxia and Duchenne muscular dystrophy, that even higher doses of 2,250 milligrams per day were safe. So 900 milligrams should definitely be safe. So when you do a study, you have to have outcome measures to be able to determine whether or not your drug is working. And we use several outcome measures. The most important one, of course, is vision, because that's what most people want. They want a treatment that will improve their vision. So we use various outcome measures. Best visual recovery was essentially the difference between the, we compared baseline and then week 24, and then we took the eye where there was the greatest degree of visual recovery. Another visual outcome measure was change in best visual acuity. So you took the best vision at baseline, the best vision at week 24, and then you took the difference for the statistical analysis. So I'm just going to show a few figures here, which I will summarize, so don't worry if you know these seem a bit complicated. But essentially, on the y-axis here is a change in logMAR vision. The idebenone group here is shown in orange and the placebo group in gray. And if you look at best visual recovery for the whole group, the intention to treat analysis, there was a difference of 3 letters at week 24, but this was not significant. If you look at, again, best visual recovery, because this was the primary outcome measure, but for the discordant group, there was a difference of 2 lines of vision, at least 2 lines of vision between the two eyes, the results were much more interesting, because if you look at the untreated and treated group, there was a big difference of 13 letters, and this was highly significant. So the treated eyes did better than the untreated eyes. The other outcome measure was change in best visual acuity. And again, here, if you look at the whole group, there was a difference of 5 letters, and this was just borderline significant. So it was enough to tell us that, you know, it is probably doing something, but at least using the whole group, it was not significant. But when you did a subgroup analysis, there was a big difference here. And this is quite interesting because in many ways what you're observing is the behavior of the better seeing eye. So in the untreated group, the vision got worse by 20 letters or more, whereas in the treated group, there was a stabilization of vision. So if you look at all these outcome measures, right, okay, for the whole group and for the subgroup of patients, all of them favored idebenone. So this is called a forest plot, but it is telling that if you look at all these outcome measures, the direction was always in favor of idebenone, but this was much more striking in the smaller subgroup of patients with discordant visual acuity. So the results were published in Brain, and the results were certainly very promising, and we took a lot of, you know, encouragement from the results that came out. But we also need to acknowledge the fact that these promising results were based on subgroup analysis, not on the primary intended outcome measure. And as part of the follow-up to RODOS, we also collected data to see what happened after the treatment was stopped. And again, the paper was published in Brain as a letter to the editor. And long-term visual acuity data was available for 58 out of these 85 patients. And then we basically collected additional visual information. And the main observation here was, if you look at these patients, at week 24, which was the end of the study, there was a difference of 6 letters. And almost 2 years later, after treatment was stopped, there was still a difference of, there was still a significant difference between the two. And the overall message was that the beneficial effect seemed to have persisted even after idebenone was stopped at the end of the RODOS trial. So again, this is very encouraging data. And to put everything into perspective, Valeria Carelli's group from Bologna also published their experience of using idebenone in patients with LON. It was a retrospective case series of a large group of patients. The slight difficulty here is that the patient had varying doses of idebenone, not the uniform 900 milligram per day that was used for the RODOS trial. But despite the limitation of it being retrospective with different doses, it did support a visual benefit with idebenone treatment in LON. And this is a very important conclusion from that paper, is that there was an increased likelihood of visual recovery with earlier and much more prolonged treatment. And if you look at this graph, which I've taken from Valerio's paper, the one thing that you need to remember is that patients in the RODOS trial were treated with idebenone only for 24 weeks. And if you look at this graph here, which is the difference between people that were treated and the untreated group, you can see that as patients were followed up for longer, 10, 20, 30, 40 months, the difference between the two groups became wider, so suggesting that the longer you treat, the better in terms of the visual outcome. And the other important question that, you know, you will be asked, certainly we do get asked in clinic when we see patients that have been affected in only one eye and there is already a diagnosis of LON, is whether idebenone can prevent second eye involvement. Unfortunately, the answer based on Valerio's paper seems to be no, because 6 patients were treated after first eye involvement, and all of them converted in the second eye with a difference between the two eyes of 3 to 8 months. And the other point I want to make is that there is no evidence to support the use of idebenone as a prophylactic measure in asymptomatic LON carriers. And we can talk about this more in the Q&A session, but this is my position on this, that there is no evidence to support the use of idebenone if you're not affected. So what about regulatory approval? Santhera submitted a marketing authorization in 2011 to the European Medicine Agency. And the target population was patients presenting for treatment within 1 year of disease onset. Unfortunately, the application was rejected by the EMA, which is the European version of the FDA, in January of last year. And the main reason why they rejected the application was because of the small data set in the proposed target population, which was patients treated within 1 year of disease onset, there was only 28 of them. And, you know, if you change figures for some of these patients, this could actually change your conclusion. So they based their rejection on the small data set. So what do we do in the meantime? It's a very difficult situation to be in. If you're in Italy, like for Valerio, things are easier because idebenone can be prescribed free of charge to lung patients. They have a special program which is funded by the National Health Service and a special existing legislation for rare diseases. So Valerio has the chance of being able to prescribe idebenone for his patients. The situation in France changed at the start of the year because since January of this year, there is a temporary authorization to use idebenone for patients with Leber's optic neuropathy, and again, it's covered free of charge by the National Health Service. The rules for prescribing, you know, the patients have to be within 1 year of disease onset. There must be a minimum treatment of 6 months, and it has to be continued until vision becomes stable. So this is the situation in France as from the start of the year. In the UK, you know, we don't have access to idebenone. I can't prescribe it in my clinic. And in other countries where this is the case, you can get in touch with Santhera for their named patient program. And this is a slide that was provided to me courtesy of Dr. Thomas Mai from Santhera, and they've recruited more than 60 patients now in their named patient program. But for the vast majority of patients, if they want to take idebenone and they can afford to buy idebenone, a lot of patients will get it from various internet sources. And the slight caveat here is that you don't really know what dose you're getting, the purity, but this is a situation where a lot of families and patients that have been affected are desperate to get access to idebenone, so they will buy it from various internet sources. So this is the situation at this point in time for idebenone. The second mitochondrial compound I want to talk about here is EPI-743 from Edison Pharma. EPI-743 is a member of the vitamin E family, and it is a quinine derivative of alpha-tocotrienol. Don't ask me what it is. That's the information I have been provided. But the reason why it's an interesting compound is because we know that this compound reduced glutathione is an important scavenger of reactive oxygen species, and this is an important element in what we think is contributing to retinal ganglion cell loss in Leber's optic neuropathy. And EPI-743 is thought to protect against oxidative damage and cell death by promoting the regeneration of these reduced glutathione. And Alfredo Seydoun is not here today, but he published his paper in Archives of Neurology 2 years ago on his experience of using EPI-743 in 5 patients with acute LOM. And all these patients were treated quite early on, within 90 days of disease onset. And they reported a stabilization of vision in 4 out of 5 cases. And Alfredo, again, has kindly provided me with his follow-up data with the expanded data set. And some of these patients were also recruited by Valerio in Italy. And this is 2-year follow-up data on 21 patients treated with EPI-743. And the bottom line is that a third of these patients experienced significant visual improvement. A third of them remained stable. And it further did badly, as one would predict from what we know about the natural history of Leber's optic neuropathy. So again, you know, some very promising preliminary results. But obviously, these encouraging results need to be confirmed. And the only way to do that properly is to do a multi-center randomized controlled trial. And certainly Edison is considering setting up an RCT, and hopefully this will happen in the very near future. So the third compound I'm going to mention here is this compound Bendavia that, you know, Valerio also mentioned in his presentation from Stealth Peptides. And again, you know, I'm not going to go into the technical detail here, but Bendavia is thought to have a strong mitochondrial protective effect by increasing the amount of energy being produced and by decreasing the level of these reactive oxygen species. And there is good safety data for the use of Bendavia in patients. There is a randomized controlled trial ongoing at the moment looking at whether Bendavia could be helpful in patients with acute myocardial infarctions. And Ocuvia is the topical formulation of Bendavia, and again, Stealth Peptides is looking into the logistics for setting up a multi-center randomized controlled trial to look at whether Ocuvia could be helpful in patients with both acute and chronic LOM. So already we can see that, you know, 5-10 years ago there was nothing in terms of potential treatment, but already there's a lot of interest from various pharmaceutical companies to look at compounds that might be helpful in reversing some of the detrimental effect that we see in lung, and to start with small studies first, and then if it's promising, to then look into the logistics needed to do a larger randomized controlled trial. The second part of my presentation, I'm only going to cover that very briefly because Valeria has already mentioned the work that has been done on activation of mitochondrial biogenesis. But I thought because I'm covering treatment, I might as well have a few slides here, especially if people in the audience were not here this morning for the first part of this session. So there are several mysteries about Leber's optic neuropathy, and we still don't really know why only about 50% of male carriers and 10% of female carriers will lose vision. Why is there such a marked incomplete penetrance, and why is there such a marked sex bias, with male carriers being 4-5 times more likely to be affected than female carriers? And obviously what this means is that there are additional risk factors that are modulating the phenotypic expression of the primary lung mutation. So like Valeria explained, right, you need to have the lung mutation, but that's not enough to cause visual loss. So in terms of incomplete penetrance, this very important paper came out only this year in Brain, and it did provide huge amount of data, very convincing data, showing that unaffected lung carriers have higher mitochondrial DNA copy number compared with affected lung carriers. So essentially what's happening here is that you have a better compensatory mechanism in unaffected lung carriers. And in terms of the marked sex bias, as Barry has mentioned already, the obvious reason why there's a difference between male and female lung carriers could be due to female hormones, because that's one of the things that is different between men and women. Women before the menopause have high levels of these of estrogens floating around in their body. So with Carla Giordano, who is based in Rome, they published this paper showing very clearly that estrogens could ameliorate the mitochondrial defect in cell lines that had been derived from patients with Leber's optic neuropathy. And this is really relevant because if you look at, this is just a cross-section of the retina, which is the image-sensing layer at the back of the eye. And these retinal ganglion cells have very high levels of estrogen receptors. So how do you go about to try and prove whether higher estrogen levels could protect female lung carriers from visual failure? So what Carla Giordano and her team did was to basically look at controls from healthy people and compare them with the three mutations, 3460, 11778, and 14484. And if you look at this graph here, simply on the y-axis here is a percentage of cell death, right? And if you look at the controls, there is a low level of cell death, whereas if you look at the lung cell lines here, there's a very high level of cell death. And what was really relevant is that when you actually supplemented these cells with estrogens, the amount of viable cells increased. It was still quite a high level there, nearly 50%, but significantly less than when there was nothing. So this provided some convincing data that estrogen supplementation could protect cells carrying the Leber's mutation against cell death. And the obvious, you know, conclusion of that paper was whether there would be some potential treatment in the future that you could come up with that would have estrogen-like properties without the side effects. And these slides here have been kindly provided to me by Carla Giordano, who did this work funded by a grant from UMDF. And I'm only going to briefly mention, you know, because Valeria has already discussed the main findings from this study, that essentially, if you look again here at this graph, on the y-axis here, you have the percentage of viable cells, so the percentage of cells that were still living in these tissue culture media. So for the wild type, it was about 35%, and for the Leber's cell line, it was significantly reduced, about 15%. And what Carla Giordano and her team did, she basically used varying combinations of these estrogen molecules, and also a specific combination of GD and EQ. And what she found, which is very interesting, is that with this combination of estrogen molecules, there was an increase in the amount of viable cells, coming up closer to what you find in normal control cell lines. And therefore, also what she found in her experiments was that this combination of estrogen had a beneficial boost on mitochondrial DNA replication. So this is basically replicating what hopefully that we can manage is by using a combination of these estrogen molecules, you could increase mitochondrial DNA copy number and therefore protect an affected lung carriers against visual loss. So the experimental work is carrying on in vitro, and I'm sure we'll be hearing more about this area of research in the years to come. So third part, what about unproven therapies that your patients might come across by using Google or various other search engines on the internet? Well, the first thing I'm going to mention is hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Because very recently in the Irish press, there was this report of this young boy here who lost vision at the age of 12. He started treatment at the age of 14 with hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And by the age of 16, his vision had improved enough for him to be able to drive, which is great for that young boy. But I think the one thing that we need to keep in mind is that because he lost vision at quite a young age, and we know that visual loss at a young age is a good prognostic factor. So the younger you are when you lose vision, the better your chance of recovering significant amount of vision. So his visual recovery could be due to the natural history as opposed to anything to do with hyperbaric oxygen treatment. So why are some people promoting the use of hyperbaric oxygen therapy in patients with lung? Well, the main rationale is that you are increasing the amount of oxygen that is getting to your retinal ganglion cells. And by increasing the amount of oxygen, you're increasing the amount of ATP being produced. Okay, which is not bad as an argument. But the evidence is very slim. And what people are doing, they are extrapolating this from other optic nerve disorders like radiation-induced optic neuropathy. But even for radiation-induced optic neuropathy, hyperbaric oxygen therapy is very controversial. And for lung, you could make the reverse argument that actually hyperbaric oxygen therapy could be harmful, because if you have high levels of oxygen floating in your cell, this could actually increase the amount of reactive oxygen species that are being produced, and this could therefore be detrimental to your retinal ganglion cells. So my personal feeling is there is no evidence that it works. There's possible reasons why it could be detrimental, and I personally don't promote the use of hyperbaric oxygen therapy for patients with lung if they ask me what is my personal feeling about it. So what about stem cells? This is a very tricky area, because if you look, stem cells are always a sexy topic because the media always report research relating to stem cells, and there's a lot of good work being done at the moment about how stem cells could be used to understand the mechanisms leading to retinal ganglion cell loss in Leber's optic neuropathy. And there's also the potential for using stem cells to replace disease organs. But it's still at an early stage. And certainly for Leber's optic neuropathy, there's very little evidence at this point in time that there is any credible treatment out there that can help your patient. Unfortunately, if you put lung and stem cell in Google, you will come up with a couple of examples of people traveling to various parts of the world to receive various forms of stem cell injection. I'm not sure what they are getting injected, in what condition, and it could be, you know, essentially having saline injected into their spinal cord. But, you know, it's a very tricky area. And I think most people in this audience will agree that the treatment being promoted is pretty dodgy in terms of the science. It's mostly unregulated. It's expensive, you know, $20,000 for one cycle of treatment or more. And it's certainly not limited to China. I think China gets a lot of bad press about stem cell clinics in various parts of China. But there are countries in Eastern Europe or even centers here in the US who are promoting stem cell treatment for Leber's optic neuropathy with very little evidence base to support it. So my personal view is I do warn my patients about various stem cell scams on the internet. And unless there's going to be a proper study done by an established research group in a major center with a good evidence base and we know it's going to be done in a very safe and regulated fashion, I think anything out there is being done purely for commercial reason. So this is my strong view on this, and I'm sure Valeria will agree with me on this. The fourth part of my presentation is on gene therapy. And this is an area which is very exciting now because things are moving fast, and we hope that this will make a big difference to patients' quality of life if these studies are found to be positive. And the first thing that most people will think about in terms of mitochondrial gene therapy is why we don't simply replace the defective mitochondrial gene. So people are working on this, but we need to remember that this is very difficult because the mitochondrial genome is protected by two membranes, an outer membrane and an inner membrane. So it makes things twice as hard. So a way around this is this treatment called allotropic gene expression. And a lot of people in the audience will have heard of this. So what is allotropic gene expressions? If we can't introduce the gene directly into the mitochondrial compartment, what you can do is introduce the mitochondrial gene into the nuclear genome. The protein gets produced, and the protein has a special tag attached to it, which allows it to be imported into the mitochondrial compartment. So that's a way of bypassing this difficulty of cutting across two membranes. And over the years, two groups have really pioneered this technique of allotropic gene expression. A group in Paris, led by Marisol Carrara-Dabrinsky and José Sahel, and a group of John Guy at Bascom-Palmer. And I'm not going to summarize all the data out there, but they've published several papers over the years showing that retinal ganglion cells can be rescued with preservation of visual function. So based on this, on these data, both in vitro and in vivo in animal models, what they are doing now is moving forward with early stages of clinical trials for patients. So the Paris group, in collaboration with GenSight and with the Cairns Van National Eye Hospital in Paris, have started the first phase of their gene therapy trials. And the first phase will be really about the safety of using this gene vector when injected in only one eye of patients with chronic LON. And the first patient was injected in February of this year, and recruitment is ongoing in Paris to determine whether this vector is safe. And if the vector is found to be safe, then of course there will be a second phase in terms of looking at whether they can use this vector to rescue vision in patients affected with LON. And in parallel, John Guy's group in Bascom-Palmer have secured funding from NIH, and they will also be starting recruitment soon into their gene therapy trial. So there's absolutely no doubt that this is an important research milestone in terms of treatment for Leber's optic neuropathy. And the launch of these clinical trials will provide a lot of data. But we also need to be cautiously optimistic because there's a lot of experimental data, but really we will only know when patients are treated whether it's going to be efficacious. And also we need to collect additional data in terms of long-term safety, because safety is paramount to everything that we do. So these studies, both in Paris and in Bascom-Palmer, will provide a lot of information on gene therapy for Leber's optic neuropathy. So the final part of my presentation, because you might be getting bored with me already, is about preventing germline transmission for mitochondrial DNA mutation. It is a really exciting area of research that is moving very quickly, at least in the UK where I come from. And we all know that the mitochondrial genome is a double-stranded circular molecule. It's quite small, and it shows strict maternal inheritance. So 3 years ago, this was big news in the media and was reported by all the media outlets all across the world, the so-called free parent embryo. Not the best term to describe the technique, but that's what the media does. They latch onto a term, and the term they wanted to use is free parent embryo. But it is looking to a very important question about how can we prevent the maternal transmission of mitochondrial DNA mutation to the next generation. And this is very important for an affected female carriers who might want to have children later on. And this is a major research objective of the Newcastle Mitochondrial Group 1 base. And the current director is Doug Turnbull, who has been doing an amazing amount of work on the basic science relating to this new IVF technique and also trying to promote the use of this technique to help patients with mitochondrial disorders. So what is the science behind this potentially revolutionary technique? Because it is, you know, revolutionary in terms of what they plan to achieve with it. So again, there's been several very important papers over the past 4 to 5 years on preventing transmission of mitochondrial DNA mutation. I'm just mentioning two here, one from the Newcastle group and the other one from a group in Oregon led by Shukrat Mitalipov, who's also looking at an IVF technique. Not exactly the same, but they want to achieve the same aim. And these two techniques are called pronuclear transfer, that's the one which is being studied in Newcastle, and the technique in Oregon is called multiple spindle transfer. I'm not going to go over the technique, but I'm just going to illustrate what we are trying to achieve with this technique. So in pronuclear transfer, you have a patient couple here where you have the 40 mitochondria, and after fertilization, the nucleus is removed. On the other side, you have a healthy female donor who has healthy mitochondria. You remove the nucleus, and then you combine the two together. So the fertilized nucleus is put inside this donor egg from this woman here. And then, you know, it goes through the normal process of IVF. And then this is implanted in the, potentially, in the mother. So, as for most new techniques, there's a lot of a debate, both for and against. And there are a lot of reasons why people are against it, ethical, moral, religious. And that's the reason why, you know, over the past 2 years, there's been a lot of consultation in the UK about whether or not it is the right thing to do. So last year, the UK government had a public consultation that allowed clinicians, scientists, patients, various groups to come together to give their views about whether or not it should be used in patients with mitochondrial disease. And I'm just going to summarize the conclusion here from the Nuffield Council of Bioethics. So their take on it is that this novel technique, if proven to be acceptably safe and effective as treatment, it would be ethical for families to use them. So a positive backing of this technique. But I think we also need to remember that we still need a lot more information about the safety of this technique, because in the papers that have been published, a proportion of manipulated zygote showed abnormal development in vitro. And additional research is being done now to look at the safety of this IVF technique in higher primates. And there's good evidence that this technique will be safe. So the same discussion is happening here across the pond in the US, and the FDA has recently convened a two-day advisory panel in February of this year. And this guy, Ivan Snyder, is the chairman of this committee. So at least here in the US, they're a bit more cautious. And from his quote here, the overall conclusion of the panel was that there was probably not enough data to conclusively move on to human trials. So they are still wanting more information in terms of the safety of this technique. In the UK, things are moving faster, and in February of this year, the UK government has announced the decision, has basically started the process to draft regulation. And if the regulation is drafted, then it will have to be debated in Parliament, and then people have to vote. So there's still a long way to go, but certainly things are moving much faster in the UK compared to the US. And just as I'm finishing, I think it's important to mention about the situation for unaffected lung carriers. Because genetic counseling remains very challenging, because we still are unable to say with any great accuracy whether someone is going to lose vision or when they are going to lose vision. Of course, we can base the risk on age. If you're older than 50, your risk is much lower. If you're male, your risk is 5 times higher. But what does it mean at the individual level? It's an imperfect science, and we're all faced with this in clinic. Then there is no evidence to support any form of prophylactic treatment in lung. But the one thing that we need to stress to everyone that we see in clinic, and it's just common sense, is the need to have a healthy diet, not to smoke, absolutely not to, you must not smoke, because there's very good evidence that if you smoke and you're a lung carrier, instead of having a 50% risk of losing vision, your risk is 100%. So smoking, if you're smoking, you're increasing your risk of losing vision by 100%. About drinking, I don't have a complete ban on it, but I think people need to be sensible. If they're going to drink, it's one drink, occasional one, no binge drinking, you're not going to get drunk out of it. And also, I think it's sensible to avoid certain antibiotics, for example, ethambutol, which is known to have a detrimental effect on mitochondrial function. So just to summarize here, because it's been quite a long stretch from when I started, lung is an important cause of mitochondrial blindness among young adults. You absolutely need to give hope to your patient because, you know, things are moving in the right direction. But you must also be frank about the current limited treatment options and also warn them about treatments that might not work. For example, dodgy stem cell treatment that you can get access to on the internet. And it's great to be here because, you know, when I started research in Lund, that was back in 2000, it was really, everything was about the genetics, the basic science, nothing much about treatment. But now, that's where a lot of the research is going. How do we translate things from the bench to the bedside? And I think this is going to be an exciting area of translational research. And finally, I think the reason why we're here and the reason why we're putting all this effort together, it's very clear that any treatment that is found to be potentially beneficial for labors will have to be verified in a properly powered randomized controlled trial. And that's where multi-center collaboration will be very important. And I'm very lucky to count among my friends, people like Valeria Carelli, Alfredo Seydoux, and Nancy Newman, and we are all there to work together to make these trials possible. So I just want to show this picture here. It's only part of the mitochondrial group, but it really gives an idea about, you know, the great team I have the chance to work with, especially Patrick Chinnery, who's my good friend and mentor, and he's really helped me over the years, and he's also has a major interest in Leber's optic neuropathy. And also the good thing about doing research is that you get the chance to meet and work with a lot of people. You have Valeria Carelli here, and if you know about your beer, this is Newcastle Brown Ale here, right? And Chiara also is here in the audience, and all these people are really working very hard to find treatment options for patients with Leber's optic neuropathy. So thank you very much.
So if Valerio Carelli, if you would come up to the table here, and Dr. Yui Men over there, and we'll take a few minutes for questions before we have our break.
Good afternoon. I have two questions. One, what is your, my name is Audrey Davis from Massachusetts. What is your feeling on hormone replacement therapy for an unaffected carrier? And also, as far as a younger brother who's not affected yet, would you suggest any action, any doctor's appointment, something we should watch for that we're not aware of?
Very good questions. So, a consequence of our studies on estrogens are obviously that when a female undergoes menopause and lowers the levels of estrogens, it gets somehow back to the same risk as males, even though the probability of getting affected is also age-related, and for some reason the peak is between 15 and 30, 35 years of age. But it's a matter of fact that in all the epidemiological studies, the female average age of onset is slightly later than males, which might be due to the fact that some of the females are getting the disease as males in young age, but some are actually getting affected later on after menopause, or because for any reason they have lower estrogen levels. So I have just anecdotal data, scattered cases. One, definitely I have in mind one case where, because of primary amenorrhea, this woman got affected, and we didn't coordinate with the other doctor, but she got the hormone replacement therapy and she got better, much better. Very recently, in two cases where women were obviously being affected through the menopausal period, I asked to do also the hormonal replacement therapy, but it's not evidence-based, so it's purely anecdotal. What we're doing now, and it's part of the Carla Giordano's project, we will be running, together with Patrick and with other colleagues here in the United States, a survey to understand exactly how many of the women population is actually getting the disease in this postmenopausal period, if there is a peak there, and then we will be asking the question, should we try to actually make it smoother using the hormonal replacement therapy. But right now, I don't have a clear evidence-based answer to give you. And concerning carriers, in particular young boys, my recommendation is that we can measure things in the eye now that are predictive if the situation is somehow getting towards the point where the disease would start. In particular, measuring by OCT the thickness of the retinal nerve fiber layer. Piero Barboni, he's not here, but he pioneered this approach. It will tell us if on the temporal side where the papillomacular bundle fibers, the ones that are lost when the patient comes to us with loss of vision, if they're getting swollen, because swelling is a bad sign that the disease is about to start. So the point is, once we know that, what we're gonna do? And this is a good question. We don't have an immediate answer, but maybe at some point, if you feel that we are pretty close to the beginning of the disease, we may decide. We may decide to try to administer some therapy, and edibenon would be one, or I don't know. I mean, in the next few years, we will have a few options for that. But I agree with the conservative position that Patrick gave to you in his talk. Right now, we don't have any evidence that we should treat carriers. But if you have mounting evidence that you're approaching the beginning of the disease, then I would have a thought.
Yes, I think the important thing about an affected carriers who have the LON mutation is, first of all, having the knowledge that they have this risk of losing vision. And having the knowledge of losing vision, it becomes more important to try and reduce the risk factors that might be increasing your risk of converting to the disease. So smoking is a major issue. So if you're smoking, you have to stop. You have to stop smoking by one way or the other, because there's very good evidence based on what Valerio showed this morning. There's a lot of reason why smoking is bad, because it contains various toxins that poison your mitochondria. And if you stop smoking, not only will it improve your long-term quality of life, but it will also reduce your risk of losing vision in the first place. And there are also other sensible things that you can do, because there is also anecdotal evidence that exposure to various environmental toxins or exposure to smoke can increase your risk of losing vision. So it makes sense to reduce your risk to these various environmental exposures that might be a trigger for visual loss. So I think this is an important thing, that healthy living, get your 5 portions of fruits and veg, don't smoke. If you're going to drink, moderate your drinking and reduce any potential exposure to environmental toxins.
Dr. Corelli, can I ask a follow-up question? You mentioned the OCT exam, and I don't know if all the patients here or families would be aware of an OCT exam. Is that something they might ask their ophthalmologist to consider doing an OCT exam on their carrier family members and sort of invite them to watch this talk and begin to understand the swelling issue? Because not everyone's doctor would know that.
Well, I'm not strictly an ophthalmologist because I'm a neurologist, but I think OCT became very common in an ophthalmological practice. So definitely, as a package of what you do, if you want to know what's the situation like in labors for yourself, you would have an OCT done. And neuro-ophthalmologists are definitely more qualified than just the general ophthalmologist, I think.
And certainly the work that you and Piero Barboni did on showing this fluctuation that can happen in some unaffected carriers, it's true that what it's telling us is that the retinal ganglion cells are not happy. That's why you have these periods of swelling, and then they go back to normal. The slight difficulty here is, even if you do find a swelling on the OCT, it does not tell you whether or not you will definitely be losing vision. You could be if there's a crescendo happening. I think there's also the issue of access to seeing ophthalmologists if you're unaffected, because you will have to pay for it, I presume, here in the US. In other European countries, there's issue of whether we can provide an appointment to unaffected carriers. It's to do with rationing of healthcare. So I think it's very interesting to understand the disease involved in terms of these retinal ganglion cells being unhappy, but there must also be a question mark on what it will tell us from a practical point of view.
Yeah, I was just going to add one last point to the previous question. I also recommend, in particular, young boys of not doing any activity, particular sports, which may imply repeated traumatic injuries to the head, because there is some scattered, again, anecdotal evidence that head trauma can trigger the beginning of labors. So don't play American football, for example.
When you talk about tobacco and alcohol, are you talking specifically about the acute phase or the onset of the disease? Like, my husband has had it for 2 years now, and, you know, he might want to drink tonight for the Miami Heat game. Like, how does alcohol after the acute phase affect? Obviously, I know any doctor's going to say you shouldn't drink and smoke, but I just wondered, what's the implications of drinking?
I think there's two elements to it. One is, if we talk about unaffected carriers, we do know that for unaffected carriers, that if you smoke, you significantly increase your risk of losing vision. So, to start losing vision in the first place. Because, for example, if you say, roughly speaking, if 50% of male carriers will lose vision during their lifetime, if you smoke, it's not 50%, it's 99%, right? It's the same for female carriers. So if you're an unaffected carrier, you should definitely not smoke, because smoking will increase your risk of losing vision in the first place. As to whether or not you should be smoking, if you're already affected, the question is a simple no, you should not be smoking. Because even if you don't carry a lung mutation, smoking increases your risk of other eye problems, early cataracts, age-related macular degeneration. So there's a whole list of reasons why you should not smoke, not just for the eye point of view, but also from a systemic point of view, to improve your general health. When it comes to drinking, when we did this study looking at risk factors for visual loss in unaffected carriers, there was a positive signal. So people who drank heavily, indulged in binge drinking, had an increased risk of losing vision. The risk was not as strong as for smoking, but certainly the message is very clear that if you drink heavily, way above the normal limit, and if you binge drink, so you basically go out on a Saturday night and basically get yourself drunk, it's not good either. So, you know, depending on where you are, it's very difficult to be strict about everything. Definitely, you have to be very draconian about smoking. But for drinking, you could say, well, be sensible here. One glass of wine or one pint of beer, perhaps occasionally, and that's enough. And to do, if you're affected with labors and you want to enjoy one bottle of beer or one glass of wine, sure. But, you know, I think everything in moderation to reduce your risk of other complications that you might get if you drink heavily.
I think one piece of the question also was, there seems to be a notion in the community that you're either unaffected or affected. You have an acute phase and it's kind of over. Would you say that once someone has reached the affected stage, it's over? Or is there a progression even beyond the acute stage where there's sort of an interest in protecting what's left? Could you address that point?
Well, there is certainly evidence that for all of us, as we grow older, we lose retinal ganglion cells. It's a normal age-related phenomenon. And there is possibly evidence in labors that as after the acute stage, in the chronic phase, you're still losing these retinal ganglion cells and your vision can be getting gradually worse over time. So anything that you can do to reduce your risk of killing off further retinal ganglion cells would be beneficial.
Yeah. In particular, if you have very few axons and cells left, if you lose once in a while a cell, if you have a full complement of, as an age-related spontaneous natural phenomenon, it's one thing. But if you have very, very little left, each single cell that you lose on top of what you already lost, it cares a lot, I guess.
Sorry.
many.
What, go with Lisa. Mark? Hold on, Lisa. He's got the microphone.
Just a question. I've met several women who have exhibited LH1+ after they've had pregnancies. So I was just wondering if hormones with pregnancy, if that would change and make the symptoms develop as well.
Well, I have, anecdotal evidence that in certain families, at least I have in mind one very clearly, where more than one woman had postpartum beginning onset of the disease. And surely that's the period where you have a depression of your estrogen levels. So it could be a little bit like menopause, that you are more at risk of being unbalanced from the metabolic point of view. But it's still very scattered and anecdotal evidence.
Okay.
I think the important message is that labor is a disease of young adult males. So overall, female carriers have a much lower risk of losing vision. And therefore, that's the reason why it's important to do a much larger study, as Valerie mentioned, to look at all these other possible risk factors. Because the rarer something is, the more people you need to study to be able to come up with clear positive signal. Otherwise, it's just anecdotal observations. And we need to be careful about this.
And while I would never want to disagree with our esteemed scientific colleagues, I see some frowns in the room from some affected women, so I'm going to speak for them and say, while it is a disease of young men, I think that one of the issues that the affected women have dealt with is because people hear that, they have a difficulty getting diagnosed. So on the one hand, it's true it's known as a male disease, and yet, for the women in the room who are struggling to get diagnosed, it's also important, you know, for the women to be heard and to understand that we have to, you know, be watched out for also. Chris, did you get the, yep.
Yes, and I fully agree with you, Lisa.
Yeah.
Mariella Simon from Jock Children's in Orange County. We care for a family with the 11778 mutation, and they have a little girl, 7 years old, with intermittent hypoglycemia, fatigue, myalgia, and we wanted to see if we should recommend Idebenon for that little girl, or is that not recommended at that time?
Well,
I'll join you.
We need to have some evidence that these adjunctive features are related to mitochondrial dysfunction before we make the decision that Idebenon is a therapy that we want to give. What we do in Italy, there are means to study in vivo metabolism. For example, lactic acid after effort raises, or by MRI spectroscopy, you may measure lactic acid in the muscle and in the brain. So if you have evidence that there is a wider expression of the mitochondrial disorders, which becomes like Leber's plus, multi-systemic, is not just, then it would be appropriate to take to give a therapy, I guess. Yeah.
I think it's a very difficult decision to make, because as Valeria was saying, especially if this young child does not have any visual problems, is whether or not these could be unrelated to the actual mitochondrial DNA mutation. I can remember an affected male carrier in Newcastle who had a lot of prominent fatigue, muscle problems, that we did MRS on, which is a special scan to look at whether or not, you know, they might be producing increased amount of lactate and whether there was defective energy production by the muscle, and it was normal. But in any case, he also had coenzyme Q10 because we were able to provide coenzyme Q10, and he did not really benefit from it. So I think it's very difficult. The patient obviously has a problem, right, because it's affecting his quality of life. But it's very difficult to prove it sometimes, even when you do objective measurements, and even when you use treatment that we know is safe and possibly might help, like coenzyme Q10, because it's used by a lot of people in treating mitochondrial disease, it doesn't have any effect. So I think here I would err on the side of being conservative, especially because we don't really know whether it's related or not.
Chris, this side of the room, you got a whole bunch of hands. Second row, Chris, up front. We got one right here. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Gail, and I'm from Ontario, and we do camping. And I've been hearing tobacco smoke, but I'm just wondering about fire smoke, like from campfire pits. Is that going to be any problem? Is that a myth?
I would certainly avoid any possible source of environmental toxins, and that includes, you know, camping smoke or fireworks smoke, so anything that could possibly be detrimental. And in any case, I don't think it's a good idea to be exposed to any form of smoke directly. But if you do have a lung mutation, I would personally not take the risk if it can be avoided. What do you think, Valerio?
Yeah, any. If Alfredo was here, he would say any smoke, even barbecue. It's smoke contains a number of toxins that directly impinge on the mitochondrial function. So on top of the Leber's mutation, it becomes a risk, and you don't want to take it, just this. Yeah.
Jim Leader, you touched on the way the press have handled the mitochondrial replacement IVF techniques. There was a report out just a few days ago, and even the BBC, which you may or may not regard as unbiased, its report, the first two paragraphs were all about three-parent babies and a possibility of a designer baby being produced. And it wasn't until he got way down the page that it talked about the regulatory authorities being involved. Is there sort of more that could be done to promote the science that has been done? Because I've heard reporters complaining, saying, well, this has just been suggested by scientists and they haven't done the research to back it up. So there's skewed views already being put out in the press.
Right. Hi, Jim. Good to see you. I think overall we're quite lucky. There's a lot that needs to be done, but certainly Doug is not here today, but him and the Wellcome Trust have done a huge amount of work to try and provide a balanced view about this new IVF technique and what it will and won't do in terms of changing someone's genetic makeup. But despite all the care that you take to promote the science behind a new technique, whether it's a new IVF technique or a new treatment, you can't influence what the tabloid press will decide to promote out there. But the fact that the government has allowed this consultation to happen last year and there's been a new wave of consultation this year, there is a real drive to promote the science behind it. I think a lot of people are very balanced that it is a new technique that can have a major impact on patients' quality of life. And here we're talking about labor, which is really a terrible disease to have because you're losing vision. But there are other mitochondrial disease which affect young children where it's invariably fatal very quickly. So the benefit is huge, but of course you need to have the safety data, and that's what a lot of groups are doing in Newcastle, in Oregon, to basically get the additional safety data. So if you have a technique which has been shown to be safe, can have a huge impact on a patient's quality of life, then I think we should be looking into it in a very impartial view and put things like religious views slightly out of the way.
I think we could go on with questions for a very long time. I'm going to let Chris go to one more question, and then we're going to take two more questions. Okay, go ahead, Chris. Hold me up here. What were you doing?
Hi, I'm Trish, and from Warrington, Pennsylvania. My question to you is, are you seeing more younger male kids that are getting LHON? Because my son is 8, and he was just recently diagnosed in March.
Right. Personally, I'm not seeing an increased referrals of patients with labors with young onset, less than the age of 15. It is certainly an important subgroup, but I'm not seeing an increased number in my clinic.
No, I don't have this feeling that there is an increase in early onset cases. They exist as a subgroup, and they have some peculiarities that has been published and described. They're so-called childhood cases. And the good news is that usually they do better than the adults. So they either the disease is milder or they have higher probability to recover vision later on. So.
Hi, Dr. Uyman and Dr. Crowley, thanks so much for coming. Excellent discussions, and I think I have about a million questions, but if I could give you two. One is a reflection, Dr. Crowley, on the great kind of genetic inheritance piece that you gave us. So what it does, it helps the unaffected people probably more, obviously, because it lays out some kind of risk, what the risk is going to be. The flip side is, because of the variable penetrance, triggers become kind of an important thing, and you've been talking about smoke and that. Is there a database that exists that looks at, and we talk kind of vaguely always, oh, there's toxins, but that really looks at, you know, is there one or more other than cigarette smoke toxin? Is there a database that actually looks at what, you know, perhaps what was everyone exposed to a little bit before? Is there a plan to do that if it doesn't exist? And secondly, if I could just, I'll just jump ahead and say, is there a mechanism that we understand by which vision returns? It's kind of interesting because it's like a neuronal loss. You have an apoptotic process, and then all of a sudden, the vision returns. It's kind of like you have death and it's a resurrection. Maybe you just reflect on that.
I'm glad you asked this. I'll get started on this last point. Yeah, it's not the resurrection. There are good evidence that people recovering vision has more anatomical material left in the eye. This was demonstrated quite clearly by OCT. The thickness of the retinal fiber layer in people recovering is thicker than people not recovering. So essentially, the idea is that you have to have more axons or fibers, call it as you want, left in the eye. But the point is that the visual acuity and the visual function doesn't use all the fibers which are left. So the room that you have to improve vision is probably related to the fact that you are recovering some axons which are like sleeping within the nerve, because they're profoundly damaged, but they're still not dead. They're not disappearing yet. So if you avoid these axons to finally die, so you keep them into the system, and you improve the functionality, and in the end they get back to function. That's exactly why we are getting back some vision. And one personal view on why is this happening is that one key point is that many of these axons are profoundly demyelinated. As Patrick showed, you can have the axons left into the optic nerve, but without the myelin wrapping anymore in a scattered way. So the signal, it doesn't travel along that particular cable. If you remyelinate, if you rebuild the myelin around the axon, you restart signaling along that cable, so you gain one more cable to send the image signal from the eye to the brain to produce the image.
A little bit of guidance over what to say to their doctors about possible dosage levels for, let's say, an eight-year-old, where it's easy to pass over a copy of the RODOS trial and say, this is what's recommended, what do you think? When it comes to juveniles, most doctors haven't got a clue, and the parents are left completely without guidance. Thanks.
Patrick, I'll give two quick answers, but then, concerning the difference between coenzyme Q and IDB1, I guess the main thing is that IDB1 crosses the blood-brain barrier much better and enters the cells much better. So essentially, the key features of the molecules are very similar, but it gets in the right point where it must function in a more efficient way. So I would say IDB1, because coenzyme Q is, there are no data about coenzyme Q, if it does something or not. And concerning the What was the other one?
The dosage.
Well, the dosage in the child cases, there are papers about, at least in terms of safety, there are papers about Friedreich ataxia suggesting dosages for pediatric ages. So you can get some guidance from that. And it's pretty safe. I mean, it has been used at high dosages in Friedreich ataxia.
And also, I think the angle I'm going to put in here, I agree with Valeria that if you look at the pharmacokinetics, certainly Idebulin can cross the blood-brain barrier and should be better at improving mitochondrial function. In the UK, because we can't prescribe Idebulin, and a lot of neurologists have access to coenzyme Q10, very often they will provide coenzyme Q10 to their patients who have been newly diagnosed with Leber's optic neuropathy, although there is no evidence that it's helping the disease process. It's simply being used very often because both the doctor and the patient feels desperate that they need to do something. And the only thing that you can prescribe is coenzyme Q10, not Idebulin. So it's also partly an element of wanting to try at least some that we know is safe, although there is no evidence that coenzyme Q10 works for Leber's optic neuropathy. So I just want to add this angle because it's very different from you, Valeria, because you can prescribe Idebulin.
Well, it applies the same for vitamin B12 and folic acid. Unless you have a clear-cut deficiency of these compounds and you have to provide them, it has been one of the anecdotal therapies used in the past. And again, there is no evidence in favor or against. There is no studies actually proving something.
Okay, I'm gonna wrap this up. I'm gonna say thank you very much, and we're gonna come back at 3:55. We're a little bit behind schedule, but they're gonna be here, and I'm sure they'll continue to answer questions off to the side. So again, thank you so much.
Thank you.